Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Bright spots in the COVID-19 management in India, successful vaccination stories. That's what we're going to talk about. Just as we look back a little bit, we've seen individuals and organizations step up through this period of crisis in ways that we've obviously never seen before and for such consistently long periods of time. We've seen dedicated and inspiring work from people we never expected, apart from all the frontline health workers, medical workers, scientists, and researchers who've been at this now for almost 2 years. As India crosses and crossed 1 billion vaccine doses, there is much to think about and look back, even as we ponder about the road ahead, which is long. But this is also a moment to recognize the sheer hard work and ingenuity and the stories, most importantly, that will bring joy and inspiration in equal measure to many of us, if not all of us, even as we continue to rededicate ourselves at the cause ahead of vaccinating everyone and getting rid of COVID-19. So that's a small introductory note. Thank you very much for joining us, everybody. I'd like to now welcome Dr. Soumya Swaminathan and Sri C.K. Mishra. A quick background on both of them. Dr. Soumya Swaminathan is the World Health Organization's first chief scientist, appointed in March 2019. She's a pediatrician from India, globally recognized researcher on tuberculosis and HIV. Brings with her 30 years of experience in clinical care and research. Earlier, she was secretary to the Government of India for Health Research and Director General of the Indian Council of Medical Research from 2015 to 17. Since the pandemic, she has been at the forefront in advocating for vaccine equity and is also a member of the board of the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, or CEPI. I'm also pleased to welcome Sri C.K. Mishra, or Chandra Kishore Mishra, who is presently serving on the senior advisory board of the Exemplars in Global Health Program and as a non-executive director on the IPE Global Board. He is a career civil servant. He joined in 1983 and retired in May 2020. And more recently, from 2013 to 15, he was additional secretary and mission director of the National Health Mission before being elevated to the post of secretary, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. He's recognized widely for his significant contribution to improving the public health landscape and earlier associated with delivering healthcare at the provincial level and played a key role in eradicating polio in the toughest region of Bihar. He has been the force behind Mission Indradhanush, the largest ever focused campaign to immunize children, something that I'm sure many, if not all, those who are watching today are familiar with. His views on maternal child health are well accepted globally, and he brings a practical implementation perspective to his views. So on that note, we are going to start off, and thank you very much. Thank you on behalf of India Spend for giving us the opportunity to partner on this very, very important initiative. We are a data journalism initiative. We use data to tell stories, and it always gives us great pleasure to listen to stories which we can use to hopefully inspire many more. On that note, it's over to you, Purnima.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Govind. Today, I join you all on behalf of the India COVID SOS Volunteer Network. My name is Purnima Menon. In my day job, I work on nutrition with the International Food Policy Research Institute. Since April, I've been volunteering with the India COVID SOS network of researchers, clinicians, engineers, and so many more people. Could I have the next slide, please? So I wanted to just take a moment to say who India COVID SOS is, what our goals are, and what kinds of work we do. In April 2021, as India's second wave sort of took off in an unrelenting way, a large coalition of about 500 plus volunteers, which included scientists, clinicians, engineers, epidemiologists, policymakers, and several others, many of whom are Indian diaspora with lives outside of India, but roots and very deep roots in India, were ignited into collective action by that unprecedented surge. There was a real sense of urgency, a sense of really wondering what we could do without necessarily being on the ground. And so the group came together to try to see what we could contribute, from the places that we work in, to build, share, and deploy solutions related to COVID-19, to identify and channel funds to verified organizations in India, And really to continue to expand the coalition, to learn and to see what more we could do to support the efforts that were unfolding in the context of a really tragic time for India. So that's who India COVID SOS is. It's a purely volunteer organization, and many of us have come together from around the world to be a part of this. Next slide, please. As we met and talked, actually almost every single day, we were on Zoom calls very early in the morning. If you were in India, very late at night, if you were in the US or somewhere in between, we were hearing many stories from the ground of people really making tremendous efforts to do things to make them work in what was a very difficult, challenging time. And from that, we realized that there were some incredible stories to be told, some incredible lessons to be learned. And a few weeks in, we reached out to the exemplars in global health to ask if they could actually help us to collect and put together and disseminate these stories. And this is how the Bright Spots in India Promising Practices effort has unfolded. It has really, it's centered around the objectives of collecting bright spots and disseminating them to a wide range of audiences and partners, and working together with a wide range of stakeholders and influencers. It's a partnership not just between India COVID SOS and Exemplars in Global Health, but also a range of other partners who've been really central to helping to put together and do the research behind these stories. And so I really want to acknowledge the diversity and the range of people who have been part of this network. Next slide, please. So to date, the group has collected over 70 stories. They are hosted on our website for this, especially curated website for these stories, because we really wanted to bring them together in a library. And the stories cut across five different themes at this point in time: ensuring successful COVID vaccination campaigns, providing rational and evidence-based COVID management care, supporting operational innovations for COVID-19 management from across India. Interestingly, technology and engineering innovations that relate to COVID-19, and finally, cross-sectoral collaboration, so the work that has been done by people across society. So together, it's quite a remarkable collection, and today we're just really absolutely thrilled to celebrate India's 1 billion doses of the COVID-19 vaccine by featuring some remarkable stories on the COVID vaccination campaigns. Thank you again so much, Govind and team. Thank you, Dr. Swaminathan and Dr. C.K. Mishra, and above all, thank you to our panelists who joined us here today. Back to you, Govind.
Right, thank you very much. I think this is the point where I'm going to hand over to Dr. Mithali Sethi. It's over to you, Dr. Sethi.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, Purnima and Govind. Can we go to the next slide, Pavan? I am not posted in Melghat now, but just to put things in a geographical context for everybody, Melghat is a subdivision of two blocks located at the northwest of Amravati district, bordering Madhya Pradesh. It houses a core tiger reserve, and therefore a significant part of it is in a wildlife sanctuary. More than 75% of Melghat is populated by Korku tribals. And while we have a lot of serene beauty and wildlife, we also continuously deal with the challenges of inaccessibility, a lot of service challenges because of that. I cannot, of course, condense the entire journey of vaccination in 5 minutes. And so I would love to tell this in the form of stories or decisions that changed the direction of things that we were doing. Here is our problem statement when we began vaccinations last year around March and April. We had empty vaccination centers and, quite honestly, empty villages sometimes. People locking their doors and running off to fields if we tried going door to door. Healthcare teams returning disillusioned after being there in villages for hours together for sometimes the entire day and asking questions like, is this even our job? And for us, fixing both this issue and the disillusionment was very critical. Next slide, please. All of you might remember how limited the initial supply of COVID vaccine was. The first thing we decided was to go strategically and not probably spread the doses or our energies very thin and focus on creating good examples that people could replicate. So we stopped counting the number of people that were taking vaccines and we started counting the number of villages. And a bit of intense focus and effort resulted in Chichkeda village in Chikhaldara becoming the first village in Maharashtra to be 100% 45 plus vaccinated. And it was a small village and probably we were not faring that well in overall numbers, but that did not matter to us at that point of time, because what mattered was that Melghat was now no longer a land of problems. It was a land of possibilities. And as it started getting coverage, a lot of newspaper people started coming to villages. In the next 2 weeks, five more villages adjacent to Chichkeda started achieving 100% vaccinations. Next slide. We knew, of course, that these were mere islands and a sustainable communication had to be built with people. And discussions and this basically began our own weekly Korku serial that we called Corona Harativa Melghat Jitova, which translates into Corona will lose and Melghat will win in English. The language, the actors, the script of this serial was entirely in Korku. We interviewed Korku doctors, the local villagers, the local healers that people used to call Bhumkas, all of them delivering the same message, covering the stories of good villages. And the right side that you can see is me and Tehsildar talking in Korku, delivering messages in their language. The serial received an amazing response even when, Melghat is not internet intense. Next slide. NGOs would play these serials in loudspeakers in villages. Field workers would download and show them to people extensively. Next slide, please. As a human being, many of us are probably not loud or showy or religious at all. But when it was for vaccination in those days, what people were saying was the word for us. Our instructions were very clear that irrational concerns also need to be addressed as concerns. And I remember a kaka telling me in a village that tumne mujhe tika diya lekin tum mujhe milne ke liye aayi kya baad mein? Did you check on me that aapne mujhe tika de diya aur mujhe kuch hua to nahi baad mein? And I did not tell that kaka that aapko dekhne ki zarurat nahi hai. We probably just started follow-up visits and we said that, you know, if this is a concern, then we will address this concern. This is the photo that you're seeing behind is a village in Aki where we shouted slogans of Corona Haratiwa Melghat Jitova because that was the catchphrase now. We did gut meetings, worshipped their gods before our camps. Anything that helped us connect to their culture, anything that helped us feel less of an outsider to them. Next, please. Next slide, please. I also want to focus on two simple things that we did that were very effective. Our camps were already tailored to people's schedules. We were doing very early morning camps because people used to go to fields early. But in this core village that you can see called Chopan, I went in early morning and I found that 2 hours later, nobody had turned up for vaccination. And then we did a very simple thing. We shifted an Anganwadi camp to out in the place where gut meetings used to take place in the villages. This Kaki took the first vaccination in this village and we all of us clapped for her, and there were 70 people in the village who were looking at her taking that vaccination. And in the next 1 hour, we had 20 people come forward and they said that, you know, we'll also take vaccine now. And this is a model that I think we replicated everywhere after that. Next slide. Second, many people used to tell us that they needed to go back because they needed to eat food because they hadn't eaten and vaccine could not be taken empty stomach. And after a while, we started using village funds to keep biscuits, water and even food for people, which was a great incentive. We would play nice songs, sometimes dance, and we used to say that vaccination is a festival because we are getting stronger, right? So that used to be the message for people. Next, please. Next. Once we started improving, we called for a sarpanch meeting and asked them who among them would take the initiative and make their villages COVID-free. You can see Nisha here, who is also with us in the meeting, along with Vidya, who is our A&M. Nisha spoke about her strategy and Dia became the first village, I think, where our supply fell shorter than the demand. And in the evening, when we reached the village, people were standing in the line asking for vaccination and we did not have any. And for us, it was a historic moment because it had never happened in Melghat. And I think from that day, Melghat has only looked up. In an era where we were not able to even do 50 vaccinations a day, we did 1,500 in June. And next slide, please. I will keep this slide up for people to read while I pass this virtual mic to the heroes of today, Nisha and Vidya. Nisha, start karo.
नमस्कार, मैं निशा बिलावेकर सरपंच दिया, मैं 7 महीने से सरपंच पद पर कार्यरत हूँ। मैंने मेरे गांव को कोरोना मुक्त करने के लिए जन जागृति के लिए कोविड टास्क फोर्स कमेटी का गठन किया है, जिसमें गांव के जिम्मेदार नागरिक बचत गट के महिला ने मुझे सहकार्य किए हैं। और वैक्सीनेशन कैंप का आयोजन ऐसी जगह किया है कि जो गाँव के लोग बाहर जाते हुए तो या खेत में जाएंगे तो जो रस्ते से होकर जाते हैं वहीं पर हमने मेन रोड पर ही पेंडॉल लगाए और चाय नाश्ता पानी की भी व्यवस्था की थी वहाँ पर। और मनोरंजन के लिए जो आदिवासी गाने के नृत्य के वीडियो दिखाए, और अगर से आरोग्य ठीक ना होने पर डॉक्टर भी उपस्थित थे, और जैसे वैक्सीन कराने के बाद आराम करने के लिए उनके लिए चटाई की भी व्यवस्था की गई थी, अलग से पानी की भी व्यवस्था की गई थी। और जो कोविड टास्क फोर्स कमिटी थे उनने इतने अच्छे तरीके से, जैसे मैम ने मिताली मैम सिटी ने हमको मार्गदर्शन किए थे कि जन जागृति कैसे करना है, जो वैक्सीन के महत्व समझाते, उसी प्रकार हमने कोविड टास्क फोर्स को भी जैसे मार्गदर्शन किए थे। और नागरिक हमारे गांव के जो नागरिक थे जैसे अफवाह फैले थे हमारे इधर की ये वैक्सीन लगाने से लोग मर रहे या कुछ अलग हमको दिखाएंगे तो कोरोना में निकाल देंगे, वैक्सीन क्वारंटाइन कर देंगे करके बहुत डरे हुए थे, उनको जैसे उसके महत्व समझाए। और जो इसके परिणाम स्वरूप हमारे गाँव में जो 100% वैक्सीनेशन हमने किए है। विद्या मैम बोलेंगे।
नमस्ते, मैं विद्या गावंजे NM फ्रॉम PSC हरिसाल। जब मेलघाट में कोरोना पॉजिटिव पेशेंट निकल रहे थे तब यहाँ के लोग इस महामारी को मानने के लिए तैयार नहीं थे, उनको ये साधारण सी बात लगती थी। उन्हें ऐसा लगता था कि हमें जरा सा भी सर्दी या खांसी जुकाम होगा तो ये लोग कोरोना पॉजिटिव दिखा देंगे और हमें क्वारंटाइन करवा देंगे। इसकी वजह से इन लोगों में बहुत सारा डर और गलत फहमियाँ थी, तो ये दूर करवाने के लिए हम लोगों ने उनके घरों में जाकर गाँव में जाकर जन जागृति किया, मीटिंग लिया। मिताली मैम ने मीटिंग लेकर हमें बताया कि कैसे काम करना है। PO ऑफिस के टीम के साथ हमने गाँव-गाँव में जाकर लोगों के घरों में जाकर उन्हें भरोसा दिया, इस बीमारी के बारे में हमने बताया कि टेस्ट करना ज़रूरी है, वैक्सीन लेना ज़रूरी है। हमने उन लोगों के बीच में से वो गलतफहमियाँ और वो डर को निकाला, इस वजह से लोग धीरे धीरे सामने आए, उन्होंने टेस्ट और वैक्सीन लेना स्टार्ट किया। धीरे धीरे ये संख्या बढ़ती गई, आज परिस्थिति ऐसी है कि लोग अच्छा रिस्पॉन्स कर रहे हैं, खुद होकर हमें पूछते हैं कि वैक्सीन कब लेना है, वैक्सीन कब है। और अब ऐसा होता है कि हम 100 डोज लेकर जाते हैं तो पूरा का पूरा खत्म हो जाता है, अच्छा रिस्पॉन्स दे रहे हैं लोग। धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू निशा एंड विद्या। एम आई सपोज टू ट्रांसलेट दिस?
I think it's fine. I'm assuming most people would have understood. And unless you want to paraphrase something, you know, the interesting thing is that, I mean, we reported on this story too. And, you know, one of the things we reported was that only about 600,000 people speak this language, Korku. So it's a fascinating story about actually reaching out to someone, which is, I think, one of the points. People are not obligated to speak our language, and the new person is us, not them. And I think when you connect with language, that itself removes a great barrier. So, yeah, I mean, if you want to add something, go ahead. Otherwise, maybe you can pass it on.
No, thank you so much. I called Nisha because I wanted to highlight. I mean, Nisha was one person who was herself sitting on the day of vaccination, passing out chits to people, telling them that, you know, this is what we have to do. And I think nothing can be done without an energy like that. That's probably the last thing that I want to say. Can we have the next slide? It's just, I just want to thank everybody like them because we wouldn't have been able to do anything without them. Thank you for having me.
Okay, thank you very much. Purnima, do you want to take it back?
No, I think we should just move on to the next story because, you know, for me, these are just so incredibly inspiring to hear. So thank you so much, Dr. Mithali, Nisha ji, and Thank you.
Somesh ji, it's over to you.
थैंक यू. सबसे पहले मैं जो वेबिनार के आयोजक हैं इंडिया स्पेन और उनको झाबुआ एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन की तरफ से धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा कि आपने तीन ऐसे जिलों का चयन किया है जो अपने राज्यों में सबसे दूरस्थ क्षेत्र के हैं, साथ ही ट्राइबल हैं, इसके अलावा पिछड़े श्रेणी में आते हैं. और इन जिलों ने ये दिखाया है कि केवल विकसित जिले ही नहीं बल्कि सभी ट्राइबल क्षेत्रों में अगर प्रशासन और पूरी टीम मिलकर नीचे तक काम करती है तो सफलता पाई जा सकती है. जैसा कि मिताली ने पहले बताया है कि झाबुआ में भी सिम समस्याएं थी हमारे यहाँ पर. और स्टार्टिंग में नेक्स्ट स्लाइड प्लीज. बैकग्राउंड के बारे में मैं थोड़ा सा बताना चाहूँगा कि मेरी भोपाल से पोस्टिंग, भोपाल में मैं पहले मेडिकल एजुकेशन डिपार्टमेंट में था कि वैक्सीन कोरोना के क्षेत्र में मैं लगभग एक साल से काम कर रहा था. और अचानक ही झाबुआ जिले में पूरी जो टीम इंटायर टीम थी वो कोविड से अफेक्ट हो गई थी. यहाँ तक कि कलेक्टर सर जो थे पिछले उनको भी एडमिट कराना पड़ा. और 14 अप्रैल को तुरंत ही मुझे यहाँ पर भेजा गया इस बैकग्राउंड के आधार पर कि इनको कोविड प्रोटोकॉल, कोविड मैनेजमेंट और कोविड ट्रीटमेंट में थोड़ी बहुत जानकारी है. और जब मैं यहाँ पर आया था तो सबसे पहले मतलब थोड़ा सा मतलब आश्चर्य हुआ था मुझे. यहाँ पर जितनी हमारी मेडिकल टीम थी, जितने CMHO डॉक्टर थे, सिविल सर्जन डॉक्टर थे, सभी के सभी कोविड पॉजिटिव थे और सभी फील्ड से बाहर थे. तो एक तरह से मेडिकल हेल्प भी नहीं हमारे पास थी और उस समय ऑक्सीजन की क्राइसिस सभी जगह पर थी. तो जो प्राइमरी हमारा अप्रैल और मई का फोकस था वो था हमारा कोविड को किसी तरह कंट्रोल करने के लिए. तो सबसे पहले यहाँ पर ICU बेड स्टार्ट कराया गया. मतलब यहाँ पर ICU बेड की व्यवस्थाएँ नहीं थी. CSR के माध्यम से प्लस लोगों को मोटिवेट करके यहाँ पर हमने 6 एम्बुलेंस की, क्योंकि जो छोटे जिले होते हैं जनरली ये रेफरल सेंटर की तरह यूज होते थे. और इसके बाद ऑक्सीजन की कमी को देखते हुए यहाँ पर जिले में मोबाइल ऑक्सीजन वैन हमने लॉन्च किया, जिससे कि गांव-गांव छोटे छोटे जगहों में हम छोटे सिलेंडर भेजे ताकि लोकल में जो कम क्रिटिकल लोग हैं उनका इलाज कर सके. तो अप्रैल और मई में हमारी स्ट्रेटजी केवल और केवल इनको बचाने की थी. इसके बाद मई के बाद जब 28% से हम इसको 5% के नीचे लाए अपने पॉजिटिविटी रेट, तो हमने फिर फोकस किया वैक्सीनेशन पे, क्योंकि उसी समय WHO की रिपोर्ट भी आई थी कि थर्ड वेव अक्टूबर में आ सकती है. तो ट्राइबल जिलों में सबसे बड़ी समस्या ये रहती है कि एक तो लोगों में जागरूकता की कमी रहती है, साथ ही लिटरेसी रेट काफ़ी कम है. और झाबुआ अलीराजपुर इंडिया के लोवेस्ट लिटरेसी डिस्ट्रिक्ट में आते हैं. इस वजह से यहाँ पर जैसा कि इसके पहले मेलाघाट में भी बताया गया था कि पब्लिक में 4-5 ये र्यूमर्स थे जैसे कि ये सिटी की बीमारी है, शहर की बीमारी है, ये अनावश्यक हमको बताई जा रही है. और हमको सर्दी जुकाम बस हुआ है, हमको काम बंद करने के लिए आइसोलेशन सेंटर में ये लोग डाल देते हैं. फिर दूसरे यहाँ पे ट्राइबल पब्लिक में ये था कि यहाँ पे जो नॉर्मल लोग हैं वो हमको मारना चाहते हैं, इसलिए हमें ये दवाई दे रहे हैं. यहाँ वैक्सीनेशन को सुई बोलते हैं, टीका हमको इसलिए लगा रहे हैं कि हमको मारना चाहते हैं. फिर एक जो बहुत ज्यादा यहाँ पर र्यूमर था कि हमें नकली टीका दिया जा रहा है, शहर के लोग हैं वो अपने असली टीका लगा रहे हैं, यहाँ पर नकली टीका दिया जा रहा है और 5-6 महीने बाद हमारी डेथ हो जाएगी. और जो एक यूजुअल रहता है कि इससे इम्पोटेंसी हो जाएगी, हमारे बच्चे नहीं होंगे. तो ये इन सबको दूर करने के लिए जब हमारी शुरुआत में टीम जाती थी तो हमारी टीम पर कई बार हमले भी हुए हैं. इवन कई टीम के सर फोड़े गए थे, हमारे पास ऐसी वीडियो थी तो हमने उनके खिलाफ थोड़े बहुत एक्शन लिए. फिर हमें ये समझ में आया धीरे धीरे कि लोगों का जब तक विश्वास आप नहीं जीतेंगे, उनसे डायरेक्ट संवाद स्थापित नहीं करेंगे, तब तक हमें इस चीज़ों में समस्या आएंगी. जैसा कि मिताली ने भी बताया था कि पूरी टीम जाती थी, पूरे दिन बैठती थी और सिंगल डोज वैक्सीन लगाए बगैर लौट आती थी. तो सबसे पहले यहाँ पर एक कॉन्सेप्ट है खाटला बैठक. जब भी यहाँ पे इलेक्शन होते हैं तो जो पॉलिटिकल पर्सन होते हैं वो गांव में जाते हैं, खटिया पे बैठते हैं, खटिया इज लाइक अ कॉट, और लोगों से डायरेक्ट बात करते हैं कि हाँ हम आपको ये करेंगे, आप हमें वोट दीजिए. इसी तर्ज पे प्रशासन ने खाटला बैठक स्टार्ट किया. इसमें पब्लिक से हम सीधा कनेक्ट हुए और जो भी इनके र्यूमर्स थे, जितने भी इनके मिसकंसेप्शन थे, उनको हमने दूर किया. और वहीं पर हमने जो हमारे बीच में वॉलंटियर्स थे उनको वहाँ पर वैक्सीनेशन लगाया. ये देखिए ये आपके लोगों के बीच से हैं, विशेषकर सरपंच, सचिव, आशा, आंगनवाड़ी कार्यकर्ता, इन्होंने ये बताया कि ये आपके गांव के ही लोग हैं, आपके बीच में रहते हैं, इन्हें कुछ नहीं हुआ है तो आप हम पे विश्वास कर सकते हैं. और नेक्स्ट डे हम वहां पर टारगेट सेट करते थे कि आज हमने इनका मोटिवेट किया है और नेक्स्ट डे हम कैंप लगाते थे। तो हमने स्टार्टिंग 50-100 से किया कि 100 डोज कम से कम वैक्सीन लग जाए, और इसका हमें फिर मिला कि अगले दिन हमारा 100% यूटिलाइजेशन हुआ इस आधार पे। अच्छा, फिर हमने अपने जो खाडला बैठक है इस पे सभी अधिकारियों की ट्रेनिंग कराई, और कोई भी ऐसा सेंसिटिव इशू जिससे कि क्या कहते हैं नेगेटिव इम्पैक्ट जा सकता था उसको हमने दूर किया, केवल और केवल वैक्सीनेशन पे फोकस करेंगे। और इसका परिणाम ये हुआ कि धीरे धीरे लोगों में जागरूकता बढ़ी, और लोगों को हमने ये भी बताया कि देखिए जितनी आप डिमांड वैक्सीन की करेंगे आपको उतनी वैक्सीन हमको स्टेट से एलोकेट होगी, अदरवाइज जो आपके हिस्से की आपके कोटे की वैक्सीन है वो जहाँ पर लोग विलिंग हैं वहाँ पर शिफ्ट की जाएगी, और बाद में ये दिक्कत आ सकती है कि बीमारी फैलेगी, फिर हम वापस जो 3 महीने पहले की सिचुएशन थी टोटल लॉकडाउन उस कंडीशन में हम वापस पहुँच सकते हैं। तो इन सब इसके अलावा हमने गाँव में क्राइसिस मैनेजमेंट कमेटी बनाई ताकि गाँव के बीच में ही लोग उनको मोटिवेट कर सकें कि आप लोग वैक्सीन लगा सकते हैं, ये सुरक्षित है पूरी तरह से। इसका परिणाम ये हुआ कि धीरे धीरे जो हमारे जिले में पूरे एक दिन की वैक्सीन फुटफॉल 1000 के ऊपर नहीं आती थी, हमने सबसे पहले 5000 का टारगेट लिया, उसको पूरा किया, और 21 जून को जब स्टेट के द्वारा वैक्सीनेशन के जो महाअभियान चलाए गए उस समय हमारे पूरे प्रदेश में सबसे लोएस्ट रैंक पे थे, मतलब हम 51 सभी जिलों में सबसे 51 रैंक थे, और केवल 10% हमारा वैक्सीनेशन फर्स्ट डोज का हुआ था। और उसके बाद जब हमारी ये खाडला बैठक रिलाइज हुई और लोगों में इसका विश्वास बढ़ा तो हमने एक दिन में 35,000 तक का टारगेट अचीव किया, और ये केवल और केवल ज्वाइंट एफर्ट से था, सभी टीम की जो गांव में पहुंच थी इनकी जो लोकल विलेज लेवल की डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल की ब्लॉक लेवल की क्राइसिस मैनेजमेंट कमेटी थी उसका ये एक कंबाइंड परिणाम आया कि आज जिले में हम पूरे अगर मध्य प्रदेश में देखा जाए तो हम टॉप 7 डिस्ट्रिक्ट में हैं जहां पर वैक्सीनेशन है, और आज हमारी फर्स्ट डोज 94% से अधिक हो चुकी है। तो इस सभी के लिए मैं पूरी जो हमारी टीम है उनका धन्यवाद दूंगा। और इसके अलावा हमने लोकल लेवल पे ही मूवीज बनवाई, लोकल लेवल पे इनके सॉन्ग तैयार किए जो भीली भाषा में लोगों में पहुंची, और यहाँ पर ट्राइबल क्षेत्र में हमने यूनिसेफ और MP टूरिज्म से एक ड्राइव इन वैक्सीनेशन का शुरुआत किया, जो कि ये पहला ट्राइबल प्रयोग था, किसी भी ट्राइबल डिस्ट्रिक्ट में ये पहला था। हालांकि इसका हमारे लिए बहुत ज़्यादा फुटफॉल इसलिए नहीं हुआ कि यहाँ पर कार की संख्या लिमिटेड थी, तो हमने इसको 2-व्हीलर इवन साइकिल और ट्राई साइकिल पे भी ओके किया कि अगर कोई व्यक्ति इससे भी आता है तो भी हम इसको लगाएंगे, और इससे लोगों में एक तरह से कॉन्फिडेंस मिला कि हाँ हमारे ट्राइबल क्षेत्र में जो इंदौर और भोपाल में सुविधाएं हैं वो यहाँ ट्राइबल क्षेत्र में मिल रही हैं, और इसका एक पॉजिटिव इम्पैक्ट गया। और लेसन लर्न में जैसा कि हमने बताया कि लेसन लर्न में हमारा कम्युनिटी पार्टिसिपेशन हमने किया और डायरेक्ट डायलॉग उनकी खुद की भाषा में किया, तो इसका इफेक्ट ये रहा कि आज झाबुआ काफ़ी सुगर स्थिति में है, और अगर हम देख लें पिछले 2 महीने में हमारे यहाँ केवल 1-2 ही कोरोना पॉजिटिव केस आए हैं, ये भी जो बाहर से व्यक्ति जो यहाँ पे वडोदरा अहमदाबाद जो नीरिंग डिस्ट्रिक्ट थे उसमें जो गए थे उनकी वहाँ से ये लोग पॉजिटिव होकर आए थे। तो हमें कोरोना को कंटेन करने में वैक्सीनेशन पूरी टीम का बहुत सहयोग मिला, और हम आप सभी के माध्यम से जो भी जुड़े श्रोता हैं को ये बताना चाहेंगे कि छोटे डिस्ट्रिक्ट में ट्राइबल डिस्ट्रिक्ट में भी अगर पूरी टीम एकजुट हो जाती है तो ऐसे रिजल्ट पाए जा सकते हैं जिनको आप सक्सेस स्टोरी के रूप में बता सकते हैं। यहाँ तक कि हमारे झाबुआ जिले में एक नरसिंह रुंडा ग्राम है जो कि न केवल फर्स्ट डोज बल्कि पूरे मध्य प्रदेश में सेकंड डोज का भी उसने फुली वैक्सीनेशन कराया, और इसका माननीय मुख्यमंत्री द्वारा भी इसका ट्विटर पर प्रचार प्रसार किया गया, और यही प्रयास है कि जब 21 सितंबर को भारत ने 21 अक्टूबर को जब भारत ने 100 करोड़ वैक्सीनेशन की डोज पार की तो केंद्रीय मंत्रालय द्वारा भी 3 सक्सेस स्टोरी भारत की झाबुआ की 3 सक्सेस भी बताई गई, और इसके लिए हम सभी का धन्यवाद देना चाहेंगे।
Thank you very much, Sumesh. It's great to hear the success you've had in bringing down the number of cases. And you said that many of those, I mean, some of those cases are more because of inward travel or migration. You've touched upon migration of laborers as a challenge. Any numbers there? I mean, what's the kind of inflow and outflow you're seeing, and how are you tackling that?
जो ट्राइबल डिस्ट्रिक्ट होते हैं मध्य प्रदेश में वहाँ पर एक सीजनल माइग्रेशन होता है, तो सीजनल माइग्रेशन में झाबुआ जिले से लगभग 1,25,000 लोग माइग्रेट करते हैं विद फैमिली, और ये पास में यहाँ पर गुजरात बॉर्डर है, तो गुजरात में अहमदाबाद, वडोदरा, इसके अलावा इंदौर के आसपास जो थोड़े डेवलप्ड हैं, जहाँ पर मालवा की एग्रीकल्चर है, वहाँ पर फार्म लेबर के रूप में जाते हैं। तो इसको भी हम लोगों ने ये टैकल किया कि इनके फोन नंबर ग्राम पंचायतों से सभी के लिए, और अक्टूबर माह में ये लोग सितंबर माह में वापसी करते हैं, तो हमने उस पीरियड को फिक्स किया कि जैसे ही गांव में कोई भी बाहर से आता है तो उसके परिवार को पहला काम ये है कि 7 दिन के लिए हम गांव में ही आइसोलेट करते हैं, उनको वैक्सीन लगाते हैं और उनको कोविड प्रोटोकॉल के साथ पूरा निगरानी में रखते हैं, ताकि एक तो अगर वो बगैर वैक्सीन लगाए हुए आते हैं तो उनसे कहीं कोरोना गाँव में नहीं फैले, और दूसरा वैक्सीन लगाने के बाद ही उनको हम उनके घर में छोड़ते हैं। तो इससे धीरे धीरे जो हमारी माइग्रेट लेबर है वो जैसे जैसे वापस आती गई उनको भी हमने वैक्सीनेशन लगवाया।
ओके, थैंक यू सो मच सुमित जी। ओवर टू शीर्षत कपिल अशोक फ्रॉम ईस्ट चंपारण।
थैंक यू। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल इट्स अ नाइस अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर मी टू मीट सीके मिश्रा सर। एक्चुअली I still remember sir's one of the lecture where he told about better healthcare, where the principle of affordability, equality, and accessibility. And he was mean to say that the generic drugs, including the vaccine, may lead India and help India in future. And today, when I see the 100 crore vaccine doses given by India, so it's a really proud thing. So my ma'am is also there. I met her father also, since I'm from the Pusa University, Delhi. To meet the daughter also, it's a nice privilege to meet ma'am. Govindji, Punya, Mithali, and Somesh, nice to see you. actually, East Champaran, today's lecture is about the successful vaccination story, bright spot. But if we see, there are many stories, like we are bordering Nepal, the Vande Bharat scheme, the Nepal migrants of whole India, about 70% load of, from the Nepal we have to take. Then migrant labor issue, second highest in India, 1,58,000 reported by Government of India data, we handle that. Then the oxygen supply, not only Motihari I have to supply, but also the Betia, East Champaran, one of the biggest district we have to supply. So there are many stories. Can you go the backslide, Pavanji, please? My original first slide. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. If you see the East Champaran, so East Champaran is the second biggest district of Bihar. Already Bihar has many populous districts, but it's the second biggest after Patna. In area also, it's the third biggest. The eligible population for the vaccination 18 plus was 3.5 million. We have international border, 5 blocks adjoining to the border. We have 27 blocks together. The population density is also one of the biggest challenges. 1,281 per square kilometer we have. Poor internet connectivity, of course, in the border areas, also in the areas of the rivers. Then there is it's a disaster prone. There are four major rivers, Gandak, Budi Gandak, their tributaries, and also the Bagmati River is there. So 3-4 months we are grappling with the flood issues. But the story started on the 16th January. Next slide, please.
You're on mute, Ashok ji.
Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. If I may request you to close in about 3 or 4 minutes, I can come back to you later because Dr. Swaminathan has to leave early.
Okay, fine. I'll just finish it up. The vaccination story started in the 16th January. As a frontline worker, this is a place where Gandhi has its satyagraha. So we decided to take the vaccine. So it started with the DM himself taking the first vaccine to break that hesitancy. Then the, there was a benchmark, the Bankatwa model. If the Bankatwa, what is the Bankatwa model? It's the concentrated efforts of the all departments, where and even the people's representative, the religious leaders, they come together and they mobilize the people. And we have to vaccinate. This was the first block in the Bihar. 62,000 people vaccinated in 2 days. It was a very exercise where we used ICDS services, we used health services, education services, and many other departments. Then in the month of July, we completed our all urban hotspots, 9 local bodies, urban local bodies we covered. Again, the little changed approach where we used different clubs, Rotary clubs, Inner Wheel, and all, then the Ward Parshads also. And the roadside vaccination teams we employed, they used to go walking, and in the shops we used to do the vaccinations. Then we have the certificate pasted on the doors of each shop. All the members in the shops have taken vaccination and all. Then there comes the phase of Mahabhiyan, where 3 Mahabhiyans were there by the government of India. And we decided that it's a people exercise. It's a human exercise, so we have to come with the people. So everybody, including the district magistrate, has to go on the field. So the first Mahabhiyan was 31st August, where we given 1.7 lakh vaccines in a day. We stood second after Pune. Then the second was in the 6th September, where we gave 1.26 lakhs, where we, after Mumbai, we were the second highest in that Mahabhiyan. Then in the 17th September, that was the biggest Mahabhiyan. We broke the record also. 2.28 lakhs vaccines in a day we employed. And we were after Bangalore and the Dharwad. So we were the third. So that that push was there. And the 8th October, we have vaccinated all our inhabitants, the first dose. The next vaccine, please. This is the descriptive epidemiology of the co-vaccine. This is just the statistics. In the age-wise, if you consider the, in the 18 to 44 years, 65% of the target group we have vaccinated. Most of them are the migrants. Then 45 to 60, 81%, and the greater than 60 years, we have 84% vaccinated. Again, there is a hesitancy between the types of vaccine also, Covishield as well as Covaxin. And the initially we were given was the Covaxin, and it was somehow not accepted. But the Bankatwa, the first block where we employed the 62,000 vaccines, most of them were the Covaxin. Again, the left-hand corner, the female and male percentage, if you see, we have the sex ratio of 9:0:2, very skewed sex ratio. But in terms of the vaccination, we focus that our Jeevika groups, National Rural Livelihood Mission groups, they should be focused. The women came in front, the groups came in front, and they went house to house. So women percentage is more in vaccination. And there is a rural-urban divide also, because this is majorly a rural district. So 92% vaccination done in the rural areas. Next slide, please. The key initiatives was, of course, the intensive effort model focused on the human being, and where there is a need to go every person, every department, every people's representative. Though we are ongoing panchayat elections, so initial time there was no code of conduct. So now that time we used the elected representative, because now only the government departments are focusing on the camps. Then mega camps, we focused on the mega camps. We started earlier, there were the concentrated efforts. Then community mobilization was our focus also. Seamless intersectoral coordination we have done. Basic focus was on women, because once the women vaccinated, she is worried about her spouse. So she vaccinated their better halves also. Then last mile was very difficult. In a big district like this, how to vaccinate the all the people. So we have e-rickshaws in every panchayat. We have 405 panchayats, one of the largest panchayats. So every village has an e-rickshaw. And the last few days, we employed the Tikka Tigers, where on the bike, ANM and the vaccinator goes, and they do the vaccination house to house, or near to the house, they have the session site. We have district control rooms and block control rooms for their monitoring. Religious participation is also important because there is a quite large segment in the minority section. Even in fact, the Bankatwa was the model where there is a minority population is more. And through mosques, through mandirs, we also appeal the peoples and we engage them in the vaccination. What are the lessons learned? Of course, first lesson is the ownership. Without ownership, nothing will help. So ownership has to be from the top. Second, interdepartmental coordination. It's not only the health department's program. It's the ICDS, GVCA. It has the education department. It has a police department. Because initial phase, people were very resistant. In the phase came when there was a scarcity, then there is a very law and order issues for the vaccination site. So every department has to mobilize. There should be a transparent communication. We have a mechanism to communicate with the people. When the vaccination will be done, at which place, so that the confusion will not be there. Then near to home is the principle for the first dose. For the second dose, we are house to house formula because in the second dose, we observed that people are not coming forward for the second dose, that we are it's still ongoing. Or AEFI management is also one of our strategies. Next slide, please. We don't have to stop here because the battle is still going on. The survey and reporting is very important. So what we did, we have done a survey from the various organizations. The first one was from the ASHA and ICDS Sevika Sahayika. The result is like that. Still, we found that, and we took the electoral role of our election system, and the same principle we applied, which are the people, community who are absent, so XA, which are shifted XS, which are death XD, and those who are ready to take that we have missed, because there are a lot of migrants which are coming back because there is an election, local body election, at the same time there is a festival of Chhat and Diwali here, so people are coming here. So we started vaccinated them. So we realized that still we are having around 63,000 people who are left vaccinations. We are still giving them the vaccination. Then the survey by the WHO is very critical for us. 8th October, they have done the survey where they found that inhabitants 96% vaccinated. And their analysis was that there were some issues like Aadhaar was missing. So the people are left out. Then there are some senior people who are not who are critically ill. So then there is a fear of vaccination also. Then pregnant and lactating women also left out. So we focus. Then Care India also did one survey. So they found 98%. Then Jivika also did one survey. They found 98.26%. UNICEF also did. So we had a combination of all the surveys, and we found out the reasons why this vaccination is not picking up, especially in the second dose, because COVID portal shows some gap.
Can I interrupt? Sorry. May I come back to you in about 10 minutes? Before Dr. Swaminathan, who you so admire, runs away, I just want to get away. Okay.
Thank you. No issue.
Yeah. Dr. Swaminathan, it's over to you. I don't want to interject any more questions beyond what you've taken away from what you've seen. Go ahead.
Thank you so much, Govindaraj, and it's been very inspiring and really very heartening to hear all these stories from our three young administrators. Each of them, you know, had different but similar challenges based on where they were. But we've seen how, with some very basic attention to the points that they brought out, it was possible actually to overcome the challenges. So I think, you know, for me, It's a very good opportunity and a good idea to do this kind of webinar that is learning from experiences and sharing best practices so that others don't have to repeat the same mistakes, but those who are further behind can actually already start practicing what has been shown to work. Of course, it has to be contextualized And I think, as Seema mentioned, each tribal area, even though it may have similar challenges, is different in the cultural contexts, obviously in the beliefs, in the language, in the practices. So in a huge and diverse country like India, local context matters. And I think, you know, for me, very much from the WHO standpoint as well, we make guidelines for the world, but these guidelines then need to be adapted and then implemented at the national level, at the subnational level, and then down to this to the level of the district. I must say that, you know, when district administrators take a lot of interest in an issue like this, things begin to happen, things begin to change. We've just seen these examples. And so in the past, I think some of the health issues have not been at the top of the priority list for the district administrators. I remember an example from a few years ago, and maybe CK will remember as well. We, filariasis is one of the challenges in India, and at the ICMR, you know, we were doing a lot of research. And one of the ideas that was brought to me was that a triple drug regimen, giving three drugs rather than two, would perhaps be able to actually reduce the transmission even faster, so we can get to elimination faster, because modeling had shown that you need to do these early administration of drugs for 10 to 14 years before you can get to zero transmission. But one of the challenges at the field level really was that people didn't want to take these drugs. I mean, if you go to a healthy person and say, please swallow this medicine, what happens is that people who have asymptomatic filarial infection often get a fever and a reaction when they take these drugs, because the parasites are being killed. So the neighbors and others feel that, you know, I was perfectly all right. This person took these drugs, and then look at them, you know, they've got this high fever and other symptoms. So villages were refusing to do this. We had started in Karnataka. And the way to overcome that was actually to get the district collectors involved. The district collectors came to the villages to place a medical team in the village. So that, I think one of you mentioned, you don't give the tika and go away, and then if there's somebody who has a side effect later, they have nowhere to go. So medical team was stationed in those villages for 24 hours after the drug distribution was done, because every individual child, adult was given those drugs. And naturally, there were, may have been a few cases where there was fever, just need for paracetamol and reassurance. But that changed things. And I think district collectors, district magistrates have really can play such a role in changing things on the ground. And I saw in the chat, malnutrition was mentioned as one of the challenges. Clearly in our tribal areas, malnutrition is a huge challenge. I would put tuberculosis and then stroke, hypertension as the top three. They're all interlinked in a way, because nutrition, you know, obviously predisposes both to communicable diseases like TB, but also to non-communicable diseases. And it's very surprising, when ICMR did the first survey of hypertension, the highest prevalence of high blood pressure and stroke was in the tribal districts, amongst all the districts we had surveyed. This was a surprise to everyone. You think tribal people live in relatively clean surroundings and might have a healthier lifestyle, but poverty and diet and nutrition play a huge role in NCDs. So understanding the disease burden is important on the one hand, understanding the community's perception of diseases and how they arise, and obviously they still have belief in local systems and traditional medicine, and then trying to bridge that gap and documenting, I think, like what you've done here, documenting the journey, the process, the pathway to success. It could be also a failure at the end, but it's important to document it and learn from it. I think, and that's what research is really. Research is about documenting the processes, the outcomes, and then learning from them. So I think what each of you have done, maybe without realizing, is you've done research, you've done community-based research, you've done participatory research, and that really adds a lot of value. So I think we've been discussing here also, I have a lot of discussions on how do we bring evidence and policy together. And my firm conviction after all of these years of experience is that the academics and researchers have to work hand in hand with the policymakers and with the implementers. Without that, we live in two different worlds which hardly ever come together. And However, if we talk and exchange ideas and also problems and challenges that we're trying to solve, then you can design the programs in a way that you're also learning from them. And that's one of the things that I hope can be built into the system in India, is you learn from what you're doing. I think nutrition, I know Purnima is co-moderating this, and it's her passion as well, but where are we with all the interventions that we've done on nutrition and with Poshan Abhiyan? Our indicators are going in the wrong direction. And so we need to really reflect on what's happening at the ground level and where, because it's a multifactorial problem and it needs a multi-sectoral intervention. The health system alone is not going to be in the future be able to address our health problems because of the determinants of health. So unless we address the housing, the water, the diet, the air quality, the road safety, the mental health, we cannot address health and well-being. Yes, we can solve maybe one issue. We can run a successful vaccination program and solve that. But then the rest of the health challenges, continue. So taking a holistic view, understanding the nature of the problem through multiple perspectives, including social scientists, anthropologists, behavioral scientists, I think play a very important role. We often tend to neglect the role that social science plays in public health. And then designing your strategies really to address, once you found the root cause, is it a supply issue? Is there inadequate supply or inadequate food? Is it a behavior change issue? Is it a economic issue? Is it an issue of the lack of knowledge? And it could be a combination of all of them, which then needs to be addressed, obviously, through multiple sectors. But I think this is a great example of, we've heard about vaccination today. I know you have other stories planned in subsequent webinars, but it's a great way to understand and address, at the ground level, what really needs to be done, because that's where everything comes together and things can happen as we see. It may even seem miraculous, but it's thanks to these leaders we have on the ground. Thanks.
So, can I throw in another quick question, Dr. Swaminathan? So, these stories that we've seen today are bottom up. I mean, the targets are obviously set at the top, but these stories are bottom up. There's empathy, there's ingenuity, and there's sheer persistence in getting it done. And some of that empathy is really, language, crossing barriers or lowering barriers. And as you pointed out yourself, it's actually a non-medical intervention in many ways to solve a medical problem. How do we make this bigger? I mean, how do we, go beyond these examples? Because India, I mean, every district, I'm sure, is distinct, or most or definitely states, languages, cultures are distinct. And similarly, as you look around the world, I'm sure you see similar examples elsewhere. And yet our target and objective is still common, which is to administer one dose or two doses of one vaccine to people across the world.
I think I come back to what I said, which is that health is not an issue which should be just left to the health department. Because I think everybody around the world now accepts that health is priority number one, and that without health, everything else is basically, cannot be achieved. So we cannot be an economic superpower unless we have a healthy population and invest in human capital, because that's what successful economies have done. They've invested in human capital. That's what the advantage that India has, is its young population. So I think if health gets elevated to the level, at the district level, I'm saying it gets elevated to the district magistrate and the district collector, who are reviewing and taking an interest and then trying to solve these problems. Every collector should know in their district what is the incidence of TB or of filariasis or of undernutrition, and which direction is it going in, and why, and then look more granularly at what. I think that's where the action needs to happen. I think at the national level, you can set broad policies. At the state level also, yes, the policies should also be flexible enough and to allow that agility and flexibility. They should not be set in stone. CK will have much more experience in this field. But I do think that giving priority to health, giving some flexibility at that level, and tracking and monitoring with data are going to be critical elements. And one more maybe I will say is to have a participatory model of health administration. And what I mean is that you need communities involved. And so at the district level, state level, and national level, it's high time that we have a health assembly, a people's health assembly, where the community is able to be engaged, provide feedback, and make suggestions. And the solutions will come quite often from the community. I've seen this work in other countries, and I think it may be a good time to actually do that.
Right. Thank you for that, Dr. Swaminathan. And let me hand over to Dr. Mishra. Sorry, I know you've been waiting patiently, and I was given to understand Dr. Swaminathan has to leave first. So it's over to you.
This is something that I don't like, so don't worry. Let me first and foremost thank all the organizers for this event. Because it's not very often that you have an event where you are sharing what's good, what's successful, or what's been done well. And also let me thank Mithali, Somesh, and Kapil for, you know, giving out what really matters in the field and how do local administrators look at the problems and resolve issues which perhaps at a macro level does not find attention or cannot be resolved. And the other thing I would compliment you for is that, you know, the best way in olden days, good practices were passed on from generation to generation through storytelling. So the best way to actually tell people of good or bad experience is to weave it into a story which we heard from the three collectors. So that is perhaps the most effective method of communication. And unfortunately, we've lost this habit of storytelling. And I think we need to get back to that. And similarly, I'll stick to the vaccination and the topic at hand. Indian story of vaccination has been somewhat of ups and downs initially, but a fascinating one as we moved ahead. 100 crores, 1 billion, many states with 100% coverage. You know, so it's been a story of success. And if you look at India in the COVID phase one and COVID phase two, while phase one really represented the preparation part of it, where we actually getting things ready, we saw events unfold in a manner which really did not overwhelm our systems. Our systems got overwhelmed in phase two. And that is when we were also struggling to, you know, think about vaccination, plan about vaccination, and take the country ahead. In fact, the dooms writers, many people in the country and internationally, had written us off that this is a country which really will not be able to do it. But if I may say so, you know, we had our problems, but we have found some resolution, some we are yet to resolve. Let us keep in mind the fact that we still have weak health systems. So you have limited capacity, whether it is technical, infrastructural, or human capacity. Within that capacity, what do you do best is the challenge before Indian health system. One thing, since Soumya is still around, I wanted to mention is that my view on the global vaccination story is that most of the countries are on their own, whether it is in terms of production or it is term of delivery of vaccines. So this entire fundamental of global partnership exists very much theoretically. But in practice, I think everyone has been left to his own, largely because countries have taken the stand of let me first fulfill my problem, I mean, get over my problems, then we'll look at others. And if I may say so, this is one of the critical elements of inequity in vaccine distribution globally. And I guess this is going to be the story in many more things to come. And I mean, I have always been a believer that yes, policies and programs may be set from wherever, it is country-led always. So having said that, you know, the story began early, and what these few months have shown is India's ability to take on huge challenge. I would not like to give it a name, but whether it is PPE, whether it is testing kits, whether it is vaccines, the entire production was taken over by country. And you know that even currently, there are only two companies which are supplying vaccines to India in such large numbers, one of them actually taking care of 85% of our requirement. And very soon, they will be able to look at the world as well. So we have done well because we have managed to pool all our resources, however limited they may be. One problem, which I must say is historical in India, is that we have many successful stories, but as Swami also pointed out, we just don't document. We neither document it for ourselves nor for others to learn or unlearn what was bad. So we just don't do it. So it's just as well that the COVID SOS, EGH have stepped in to identify, collate, and share some of the good stories that India has had. Because at the end of the day, it is these examples which are going to help as decision-making, you know, blocks for the future vaccination that we are going to do. You know, these stories that you were telling today actually point at this inherent strength that our society at large, the community, the village, the institutions have in India. And if you take vaccination, India's had a very fascinating story. And let me also say that this is not the first time that India has led the vaccination story in the world. You start from olden days to polio, to Mission Indradhanush, millions of children who were not touched were located in remote parts. I mean, those micro plans are still very relevant in India. So what we have done is we have created, no matter how inadequate, structures which are functional at the last mile as well. And that is one of the reasons why vaccination has been so successful in the country. And we had the A&M and the other person from Maharashtra. You know, they are the ones who've delivered. Somebody may have produced the vaccines, somebody may have distributed the vaccines, but unless it went to arm, it has no meaning. So it's the frontline workers who really delivered it for India in a big, big way. And that is something that we need to keep in mind all the time in this vaccination story. Now, let me come back quickly to the three presentations and just take a couple of minutes on that. Look at the Jhabua experience, for example. Hesitancy, main problem. What do? They use local culture. They forge partnership with the local community, go hand in hand, and make the entire program people-centric and not impose it. Melghat. Use IC in a big way, and engagement seemed to be the key word. Engage at every level, resolve concerns, reach to them the way they want you to reach rather than the way you want to go there. And that resolved the problem. East Champaran, again, is a typical example where we need to think very clearly, and particularly so in India, that every new crisis that you have does not necessarily need a new set of solutions. You got to look in your cupboard, in your backyard. There have been solutions in the past. You got to ride on them. Your micro plans, your community systems, your health systems, your interdepartmental coordination. If you can ride on them, use your existing systems well, you can actually rejuvenate the entire system. But overall, if you take the three presentations that we had today, there are two critical elements that came out. One is innovation. Everyone who spoke had done something different. And everyone who spoke had not just done something different, but customized it to the local condition. So it is about localization and finding a solution in the local settings, which has come out very clearly. And the second is that not just government, let the community take the lead. And if you can allow the community to take forefront, your vaccinations will succeed. Whether it is hesitancy or is it getting people together, it's not just the leadership of individuals. When the community gets stirred, you can step back and provide support and they will take the lead. And that is the best thing that can happen in providing primary health care, and particularly things like vaccination. So these are the two great learnings. So what do we make of it? So let me just say that I would say 4 points. First, learnings must be stored and shared. Good things must be replicated, not kept at one particular place. So everything about the health system delivery that we do, let us share with others. Create a system where we can share. We must learn how to influence. Let's get huge political buy-in by the society, by the bureaucracy, because without that, the success, and when I say political buy-in, I don't mean politics at the higher level, at the community level, the village level, the panchayat level, that buy-in must be there. How do you create that will depend on different areas. Third, where everything fails, leave it to the community to find a solution. They will tell you the path ahead. Let us not intervene too much. I mean, some would argue that let's not intervene too little. I agree. But my stronger argument would be let us not intervene too much. And the fourth broader point that I would like to make today is, what enables success in all these is partnerships. The key word is partnership. You have to partner with public sector, you have to partner with the private sector, you have to partner with the community, with NGOs. And if you can create a platform and facilitate this, I think half the battle is won. And one last remark before I close is, you know, we have a strange habit of being shy of saying that I'm successful. As a country, as a community, we need to learn to celebrate success. Because if you celebrate your success, you inspire others to do better. Let's do that as a community, and let us try and push this vaccination to a level where we can make our country very safe. Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Mr. Mishra. Can I throw a quick question? I mean, you know, we've got obviously a large part of the journey ahead. I think Ashok, for instance, talked about the challenges of giving the second dose, and that's a challenge in many parts of the country. Maharashtra has 4.7 million unused doses at this point, or at least as of a few days ago. So we've still got a lot of work. How would you, advice to these young district magistrates and collectors on how do they keep the fire burning? And I also want to put it in the context of what Dr. Swaminathan said earlier as well. I mean, we are still, health is not something that is right on top. Maybe it has become so, and that's good.
Let me respond to your last sentence first. Health is still not at the top. It's the panic of the pandemic which is changing the discourse. I hope it remains even once the pandemic subsides, because it is critical. And I always fall back on the 2017 health policy. We have to fund health well, and we have to really pay attention to primary preventive health if we want a healthy society in India. Having said that, second dose, according to me, is a big concern, and I've been sharing it with the government representatives time and again. It's been a linear progression where you have vaccinated 100 crores, 1 billion people. But the total complete vaccination is only done in about 30%. So you have a large population which does not have the second dose. I don't know the authenticity of this, but I was talking to a health official only yesterday who informed me that close to 9 crore people in this country whose second dose is due have not turned up for the second dose. And mind you, for the first time, it is not because of the unavailability or supply issue. It is because the people, a person who has to get it has not turned up. So the local administration will have to devise similar ways to locate. And one of the advice I would give is, you have done that in Mission Indradhanush. You've located every child in every village who was unvaccinated and made a separate list out of it and got them vaccinated. You know where are the people who have to take the second dose. If they are not coming to you, it's time you reached out. Otherwise, there I see a sense of complacency setting in where people are trying to say, "Ki, I think we are through." And it's critical that the districts get together to complete the second dose.
Right, Dr. Mishra, thank you so much. I'm going to say my thanks to the organizers today for bringing us in as partners. And on that note, I'm going to hand over to Purnima Menon for her closing reflections and synopsis. Thank you so much, Purnima, to you and back to you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Govind. Thank you, Soumya. Thank you, CK. Thank you, Mithalaji, Someshi, Shirshati, and very importantly, our two amazing frontline workers, Nisha Ji and Divya Ji. You have made this world move for vaccination. I just want to reflect on just a couple of things. You know, to me, this webinar, firstly, ICSOS, let me step back there, was an example of partnership across sectors. Many of us never knew each other before, engineers, clinicians, and other people coming together. Us expanding and moving over to connect with the exemplars in global health team, to all of the members across India that we met as we embarked on our own work, also brought home to me the power of partnership. And, you know, as I've reflected on what I've heard today, as I've reflected, on the exhortations to continue to bring people together, to tell stories, to distill lessons, to celebrate success, but also to accept those challenges, where those challenges exist. I'm also reminded of sort of the power of people. What I see here in this room, what I see here, across our networks, is that every single person here has had a commitment to something that's bigger than just themselves. And because of that commitment, every single person has found in themselves ways to use their expertise, their places of influence, their positions of of power in every space possible to make some good things happen. You know, in the context of something that was very much about health and very much about, you know, vaccines, which some people may consider health technology, I think what was also remarkable to me here was that social science and understanding people and understanding what drives people was so central to the successes that we've seen here. So, you know, I think what's also been so apparent in this is that in some ways, the crisis of COVID-19 shook people to their heart, and it made us use our minds, but also our hearts in ways that, you know, that made things happen, whatever we could make happen. So, you know, so I really walk away from this tremendously inspired. I realize also that I cannot escape hearing the word nutrition in any workshop about any other topic these days on health. And, you know, in a sense, I consider that to be a challenge to people like me, but also a challenge to all of us sitting in the room here to work out how we can learn from the successes of things like this, of vaccinations, to really see if we can transform some of the other big challenges that, you know, this country and that the world faces. I want to take a moment also before we close to acknowledge that for many people in India, the tragedy is still real. This Diwali will be dark. The job is not over. And in many ways, you know, I think we as a community owe it to the rest of India that preventable tragedies can truly be preventive. You know, I think we have to draw on every lesson that has been learned here to hope that the next Diwali will not be a dark one for so many people around this country. But I'm really thrilled that we've been able to do what, you know, I think both what CK, you and Samia mentioned, which is that it is important that we also come together, that the storytellers come together, that the researchers come together, and that we bring also the skills and the energy that we have to connect with those of you who are doing this important work on the ground and continue the storytelling on the bright spots and the, you know, the lessons that we can draw from all of those. I do want to thank two people in particular, if they would kindly agree to turn on their cameras, Pavan and Fariha, who have been working really tirelessly behind the scenes to not just bring this webinar together, but actually to work on pulling all of these stories together and keeping the entire team that has been developing those stories. So with that, you know, great thanks from me as well. This is a first. As I mentioned, we do have 5 other themes, and we look forward to sharing more around each of those themes as well. And then I hope one day to also share stories on the theme that I spend most of my life working on, malnutrition. There are many successes around that in India as well. And so, you know, I hope to contribute to that across the board. Thank you so much again to absolutely all of you. Namaste.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Nisha ji, Urpia ji, aapko bhi thank you. I hope aapne bhi enjoy kiya hoga.
I loved it. And thanks to the 3 young people for doing a great job. Well done. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, Nisha. Bye, Vidya.
Bye, everyone. Really nice to meet you all.
Thank you, Samesh ji, Kapil ji.
Thank you.